For today's presentation, I'm going to talk about the work I've been doing the last couple of years. I first came across Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig when I was reading Tree of Strings, which is the book by Keith Sanger and Alison Kinnaird on the history of the harp in Scotland. And towards the end of that book, there's a chapter where they talk about the end of the harp tradition in Scotland. And this was in the early 1700s. So at the time when Caroline was working in Ireland, and a generation before the old harpers that Bunting met here, the last of the harpers were working in Scotland. And Keith Sanger listed a number of names of people who we knew anything about. And most of them we knew nothing about except such and such a person, harper, died in this year. And that's all you get, or these little bits of tradition. And so one of them was Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig, was listed as having died about 1740, and that he was a famous piper and harper. And so I kind of went, oh, well, that's kind of interesting. And then later on, I did a program in Dundee where I did a concert, and I called it Music of the Scottish Harper-Composers, because a lot of people think there's no Scottish harp music, but you know, no Scottish named composers. And so I thought, come on, that's a challenge, isn't it? And so I got a half-hour programme of tunes by various people. And he was one of them, because there's a tune, A Glass of Beer, which is a pipe tune that's attributed to him. So I got it up and running on the harp. And then I kind of thought, well, another long-term interest of mine has been pibroch, the great music of the old Gaelic world, as preserved in Scotland in the pipes tradition. And although it's nowadays almost exclusively a pipe music, there are these very strong and long-standing traditions that the pipe tunes originated on the harp. All of the pipe scholars who are very pipe proud will agree with you. They say, where does this music come from? And they say, well, originally it came from the medieval harp traditions. And you say, well, tell us more. They go, well, I don't know anything. Nobody knows anything about the medieval harp traditions, so I can't tell you anything. But I thought, you know, this is a project to follow up on. How does that music come from the harp? What music on the harp leads to the present day traditions of pibroch on the pipes? It was a big tradition, you know, there's hundreds of tunes in the living tradition still to the present day. So, and then I kind of made this connection. Here's this named guy, Ronald McDonald. He played the pipes and the harp, according to tradition, and he also played the fiddle, and he composed tunes. And at some point, a couple of years ago, I thought, so we have his tunes, we know he played them on the pipes, didn't he also play them on the fiddle and the harp as well? Perhaps. Let's see if we can get them up and running on the harp. And so I started this big project to get the music running, find all his tunes, but also find out about the person. And what I found was that although we know very little historically about this man, there's a huge amount of information kind of underground in oral tradition. And so this is what I'm going to be chatting about and exploring today, is how this is a slightly different approach to getting at the historical music, not by going through the normal written sources, but by kind of going into oral tradition and trying to pull out snippets of information and put them together. So this is the kind of thing you get. This is a 1904 book, and this is somebody trying to pull together a MacDonald genealogy. And so you've got, this is the chiefs of the MacDonalds of Moira. And he says the fourth chief was Alan MacDonald. He married and he had children. Alan, his successor. So they all had the same names, and this makes it very confusing. So Alan, his successor, who was the fifth chief. Alexander, became the seventh, the sixth chief. Three, Ranald of Cross. He had a great reputation as a piper. And he was also reckoned a good performer on the harp and the violin. He was the author of several pipe tunes, and among the rest, the tune known as the Glasvir. Ranald had two sons, John and Donald. And then there's another son, and then there's a daughter. And then it says Alan was succeeded by his eldest son, Alan. So this Alan is this one. So there he is in the genealogies. And there's no sources for these genealogies. You know, people say, well, where did they get this information from? And nobody knows. You know, it's just traditional genealogies, but it's a kind of starting point. So I said, right, here we go. And so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to chase these, they're not references that I'm chasing, but they're ideas. You know, I've kind of pulled these tags. So we know he was a piper, but what about this tradition he's played the harp and fiddle? What about the tunes he composed? Let's try and chase these references and see how far we can get. Okay, now, I said we don't know very much about Raghnall from the historical record. This is it. Okay, this is it. But it's a fun one, okay? This is a list of papists in the Shire of Inverness. So what happened is the Presbyterian Church in Edinburgh was determined to root out the papists, and so it commissioned a survey of the whole country, and they want the name and address of every papist in Scotland. So their agents kind of out they go, and they tour the country, and they write their names down. And so we get to Mora, and they write their names down. And obviously they're not writing the names of every peasant and everything. This is the names of the gentry and the landed classes. So who's first on our list? Alan MacDonald. And he says, Alan MacDonald, Vic Cool. Now Vic Cool is just this kind of mythical name that the MacDonalds of Mora, the chiefs, give themselves. So this shows he's the chief of Mora. So this is our Alan MacDonald. Okay, and is it the father or is it the son? We don't quite know. I'm guessing it's the son, but you know, is that open for grabs? Okay, Raghnall MacDonald. I'm impressed that you're reading it quicker than me. So here's Raghnall MacDonald of Cross, his brother. So there's our man. Okay?
Here we go.
His name written down in 1705 when he was still alive.
As a papist.
Yeah, as a papist. And then there's various other people related to the family and everything. And then they go to the next part of Mora, further north across the river, and so on. Yeah. So this is it. I was really chuffed. So. Get hold of this manuscript. There he is, his name written down when he was alive. And that's it. So far, you know, Keith Sanger continues to read every single piece of paper in the Scottish National Archives, so I'm sure at some point he'll find another. But that's it. I should give this handout out. This is my timeline of him, seeing as we're getting to our list of papists, because that's the first, kind of the first item on the timeline. So keep this to hand because we'll refer to this as we go on. So we've been talking about Raghnall of Mora. So where is it? So here's our little map. This is my skewed map, so you can see. So it's a map of the old Gaelic world. Okay, so here we are. Okay, I can't zoom in enough so you can wave out the windows, but almost. Okay, so here's the whole of Ireland. And here's the whole of Scotland. And I chose the satellite map because you can see the Scottish Highlands all brown with mountains, and you can see the Lowlands all green. And so this line along here, this is a very nice line, the kind of the edge of the Gaelic world. So it kind of comes down here, around here, and takes some island, and then this the mountainous part of Scotland. And so here's Mora. It's this, these kind of lumps of land sticking out. And Raghnall's place. And I put Egg on as well, because he's said to have moved to Egg at the end of his life. But you see they're not far apart, and they're part of the same estates. They're part of the MacDonalds of Mora. They have a kind of feudal overlord, who's Clan Raghnall, and Clan Raghnall's estates go from here all the way out to here. So Clan Raghnall has all these islands and this bit of land right here. And Clan Raghnall was very powerful and very papist and very independent of the national authorities in Edinburgh. Clan Raghnall ran a kind of petty kingdom out there on the islands, right through until the 18th century. They were fiercely independent. Obviously, they supported the Jacobite risings and everything, because they just wanted nothing at all to do with the national forces. So that's kind of where Raghnall is. Okay. And I was looking at this graph, and I was thinking, this is kind of interesting. You know, you think of the west coast of Scotland as being a world away from here, but imagine going in a straight line. Well, imagine travelling from Kilkenny to Mora in the late 17th, early 18th centuries. I reckon this would be by far the easiest part of the journey, and the shorter half of the journey, yeah? So he's very much part of our world here, part of our world of the early Irish Harp. Okay, let's zoom in a bit, and it's going to twist as well. So now we've got north the top. So I've turned it. Okay. So this is the Isle of Mull. Okay. This is the town of Fort William. It's an 18th century town that was a garrison town started up by the British Army after the Union and after the Jacobite Risings to basically kind of to to stamp out those independent petty kingdoms. So and it was, and basically they built a military road up from here, and so it's not until after Raghnall had died that they'd actually land transport south to the west of Scotland and to England. So all of Raghnall's lifetime, this was impassable, and this was the major trading route straight down to Ireland. Okay, so here's his house. It's on this kind of little green enclave. This is very rugged and mountainous. So it's this little green enclave facing out to the sea, and this is where he moved to later in life, just across the water. And up here, this is the bottom end of the Isle of Skye. So that gives you a place where you are. Skye at the top,
Sleet,
Mull at the bottom. Yeah, that's Sleet Peninsula. So Ballaig, where you catch the ferry to Sleet, is just here. The viaduct where they film the Harry Potter train scene is here. Okay. So this is like the most scenic parts of the Highlands, where you see all the tourist brochures. Okay, I might come back to this map because it fits in with some of his actions later. So I was interested in where he came from, you know. So I was finding here's Mora, but I wanted to home in more on this cross, you know. I was looking for where is cross. I looked it in the gazetteers, and I looked it on the maps, you know, on the object survey maps, and couldn't find it. Because it's a traditionally papist area, there was a big Catholic seminary there in the 19th century. I mean, if you looked for cross in Mora, you get pages and pages about this big freestanding monument that's on the, above the seminary, you know, as a kind of landmark, but nothing about the house. And eventually I found this map. So this is the military survey. This is to do with building the military roads to control this part of the world from London. And so they surveyed it. So this is just after the Jacobite risings and after these big military crushing of all the old indigenous culture here. So here's our area. This is much closer up. Let me go back and show you where we are. So we're looking at this area here. Okay, and here's Cross. And I thought, how delightful. This is the first time I actually saw the place they've written. And you've got this scatter of houses. A little stream. So this is farmed fields. So this shows you, you see how rugged it is, and there's these clusters of farmed fields. So you know, they're living in a rich, a tiny little rich place in the middle of desolation, if you like. Okay. So I went out there, and here it is. So this is from the mountainside looking down. I didn't take this photo. This is Google Street View. It's really cool. Because I drove along this road, but you can't stop because it's a dual carriageway. So yeah, we drove along this side of it. I thought this is a cool view. So this is Sleet, and this is the mountains of Skye beyond. This is Rum, I think, the big mountainous island here. And look, you can see how unproductive this land is, but suddenly there's these green fields, and this is Raghnall's fields here, and I think his house, the stream runs through these trees, so the house was on the north side of the stream, so his house is here, basically. So I had great fun doing all this, you know, going out and working all out to give you a real sense of what was going on. Okay, so here's his field, here's his stream, you go to the end and there's his beach. This is his beach, looking towards Egg. Nice. Who's seen the film Local Hero? Yeah, that's where that was filmed, on Raghnall's Beach. So it's very beautiful. And we'll come back to the beach later on, I think. Okay, so I mentioned that there's this tradition that you later in life moved to Egg. So let's go back to the map and so you can just check out where Egg. Well, you saw a picture of Egg. Let's go back. So here we are, you're on the beach looking towards Egg. And there's this kind of mountain range on Egg called the Scoil of Egg, this ridge. And at the bottom is where the villages are. So this is the mountain on Egg, it's an incredibly distinctive shape, this Scoil of Egg.
What would the rationale be for his moving to Egg, do you think?
Well, you see, he wasn't the chief of the MacDonalds of Mora, and Cross House is the chief's house. But he lives there, and I don't quite understand why. Is he living with his brother? Is his brother away? And he lets him live in the chief's house? But anyway, at some point, he has to move. But he's given this farm on Egg. He's granted it by Clan Raghnall, his feudal overlord. And again, we don't know why. This is just a tradition, and so I'm kind of...
Yeah, but he was given a place there.
Yeah. Okay. So this is his house on Òig. I was really chuffed to find this. The house is still there, and his letter's a holiday cottage, so my next mission is this section is his house. So this is a 19th century extension, and so is this. So it's just a little double fronted with a front door and two windows. And you can see this is where the wall stopped. So it has rounded corners, like a 17th century house. And then in the 19th century, they squared off the corners and built it up and put new gables on. Okay.
And then all the rooms in the roof are in new and everything.
Yeah. So it would just be, you go in the door, they were in the passage in two rooms.
Yes.
And then perhaps there would have been an attic, but for storage and everything. It. And he's a wealthy, he's an aristocratic man. He has this little tiny house.
Yes.
But I think this is a luxury house for the time because it has windows. This is his house. And it's an important house. It was an inn for many years, and it's traditionally the house of the factor. And the factor was like the estate manager. So there's this big tradition that Raghnall was Clan Raghnall's estate manager. So he would have travelled with him. And again, I'll mention this later on. If I have time. Oh, and this is the kind of the national survey of the house. So you can see, you can see the old house with its round corners. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can see the entrance passage, and you can see the two little rooms. And look here, you can see they've drawn the stonework. You can see the old gable end, and you can see the later gable end added on. And I think originally it would have no gables. It's this kind of oval grey pan, and the roof is just kind of like a little hat sat on top. I couldn't find a good picture of a house like that. So that's given you a kind of. Let's get back to his house because it's a good picture. So this is giving you a kind of overview of his places. And this is kind of detective work. From just the information I've given you so far about that he's Raghnall, he's of cross, and this tradition that he moved to Òig, and that he was the chief's brother, and so a little bit of pulling, and suddenly all these things pop into place. There's his house, and all this kind of thing. So I thought that's good. We need to find more about him than that. So my work split into three parts. One of them was the places, and I had such fun researching these places. I haven't yet been out to Òig to look at the house, but I went out to Mora and had a good poke around the beach and everything. And that was great, and that made a lot of sense. The second strand of the research is the tunes that are attributed to him, and the third strand of the research is the traditions. Okay. And I want to work on both of those. So should we talk about tunes or traditions first, do you think? Talk about tunes. Okay. So, you've got your hand actually. If you want a spare one, so I can look at it. No, you're meant to keep it.
It's a spare one.
Thank you. So there are five tunes that are attributed to Raghnall, and I've listed them all here in italics for you. Okay. So in 1820, you've got these two attributions. In 1874, you've got two attributions. And there's one tune that was first attributed to him in 1954, and I think that's quite astonishing. I mean, the first attribution of Merle Down. When was it first written down? Okay, 1784, the first written version of one of the tunes. That's the same tune. So this tune was written down in 1784, but in 1954, an old man from just down the road from Cross House said, "Oh, shall I tell you the story of how Raghnall composed Merle Down?" Oh, you think, oh, what's going on here? But it's a convincing story, you know. So there's this whole issue of how do you believe the attributions? But I'll talk more about that when I get to the traditions. So there's these five tunes, okay? And let's have a look at what the tunes we've got and what we'll talk about then. Well, let's talk about Merle Down, seeing as we're there. Okay, this is the manuscript. So this is 1784 manuscript. How many of you know this kind of music notation? Oh, not enough. Okay, this is a kind of music notation that was invented in the late 18th century by native Gaelic musicians who did not have staff notation. So from this point of view of studying old Gaelic music, this is really interesting. Okay, this is what a person who is a master and a specialist in the old Gaelic music comes up with when they're asked to write down their music. Okay, and there's something really kind of, there's some kind of sort of cognitive thing there that's of great interest to us. It's written for the bagpipes, and so everybody goes, oh, it's utterly, utterly uninteresting if you're not a piper. And while I have a lot of sympathy for that point of view, it's important, not because it's pipe music, but because it's a native Gaelic musician's attempt to write their music. And basically, it's words, so he's just written that out in prose. It goes, hindro o ho ve o hinde o ho dro, two times, and so on, yeah?
So, is it like solfège?
Kind of, yeah. Each vowel, well, in theory, each vowel is a pitch. And each consonant is a... How would you describe it? No, I wouldn't call it a declination. It's a kind of... It's an articulation.
Articulation.
Yeah. Mm. Okay. So just by looking at this, you would sing hindro o ho ve o hinde o ho dro two times, and then carry on hyo dro o ho ve o hinde o ho da ro, and then you write the second line hindro o ho ve. Into variations. And it takes about 10 minutes to sing or play all the way through this tune. Okay. So it's written D for the doubling, which is a kind of a formal way of making that first melody more geometric. And then he writes first motion, which means the first variation, and then so off he sets writing out everything. Hindo, hinge, hinde. Two times. Hyo dro hinde hindo hyo em. Okay? And then it carries on the next page. Okay, so we're starting to make these very subtle variation shifts, and on it goes. First recording of one of the tunes. Is this tune? Who wants to hear it?
Yeah.
Alright, let's see what number it is. Come on, come on. Track 14. So this is 1927. Okay, this is a commercial recording. So this is not an old style traditional singer on an archive tape. This is a top professional traveling to London and doing a commercial recording for release on the Columbia record label. So it's a bit modern, it's a kind of modernist take on it, but it works. So we track 14, did I say? And because it's a 78 disc, and I haven't got this record yet, I'm looking for it, but it's very rare. I've got one of his other records. But because it's a 78 disc, it only has like a couple of minutes playing time. He starts at the beginning, And when he gets to the doubling, he stops because he's running out of disc. And he does something else on the other side. Okay, but I should point along, shouldn't I? So that we can follow in the score if we know this to use it. Jerking along with the fiddle bow and having difficulty following it, because this is this modernist thing. So I guess since the 1850s, the whole of Pibroch and Kilmore has got utterly corrupted by being written down by non-native scholars. And so this man in 1927 is following that modern tradition. And so some notes get stretched out, some notes get squashed and abbreviated, and some grace notes get stretched massively longer than tune notes, so that you think they're part of the tune. So, for example, at the end, he didn't play, oh, da-da-do, he went kind of, oh, and the da-da-do thing got kind of squished up.
Because I was looking for the da-da-do, and I never heard it, and I thought it was
a da-da-do. No, we see Barnaby always play, da-da-do, with da-da-da-da-da, and they turn it upside down, and they go, ba-da-ba.
Oh, right.
Just from following the written scores since 1850. And the other thing is it starts him, so you've got this kind of thing to start us off. Him, de, do, do, oh, fe, oh, him, de, oh, do, him, do. Okay, and the modern pipers, they go.
This piper is learning from a written score.
Oh, yes! But he's not learning from a written score, he's following it obsessively.
Well,
because that's what you do if you're a piper since 1850.
There's no
oral tradition.
Even in 1850?
Yeah. So there's a living tradition, but there's no oral tradition, yeah. So one of the things to take away from this is if you're going to work with this music, you've got to get to the pre-1850 sources. There's just no other option. And if you have to use a post-1850 source, because there isn't a pre-1850 source, you've got to be really suspicious of it. Okay.
Why do you think all of them, sorry to...
Oh, it's a political thing, okay?
Because surely there's some, rusty little corner somewhere, there's some old piper who has no truck with that.
Pipes are expensive, and your music is a loud public music, and you get judged on it. But there's this deliberate thing, okay? That the pipers are Gaelic-speaking, oral tradition people, but their patrons are Anglo, literate, aristocrats.
But does that mean the pipers had to learn how to read music?
Yes.
And they were willing to do that.
Okay, the way it worked is that the pipers didn't play in a kind of community setting, they played for nobility because it's aristocratic music, like our harp music. And so if the aristocrats say, you're going to play this way, you either play it or you get sacked. Okay? And it's worse than that, because what the aristocrats were very clever, because if they'd done that, they'd have fomented revolt. So what they did instead is they set up competitions. All the pipers come, and the best pipers get prizes. Okay, but you have to follow the book. Or not even that you have to follow the book, but that you get, oh, you follow the book, well, you get top prize. And so, you know, over the course of 20 or 30 years, it just sucks everybody in.
I'm just amazed at traditional musicians learning to read. Okay. You know.
And it's carried on all the way through. So Alan MacDonald was one of the people who said, no, this is not right. This is not an old tradition music. I'm an old tradition music, he said. So Alan MacDonald was born and brought up about 20 miles south of Mora, and he's a Gaelic native Gaelic speaker and a Gaelic singer, and a piper. And after a while of playing the competitions, he thought, this music is not Gaelic music. He thought, what is the connection between this modernist Anglo-written notation music and Gaelic traditional song? And he started digging, and he found actually there is a lot of connection if you look at the old scores. And so he started interpreting it in a Gaelic song idiom so subtly that people like us couldn't notice the difference, and he got utterly blacklisted from the whole competition scene, and all the pipers hated him. And it really put his career at risk, and we couldn't tell the difference. So, you know, it's that narrow a scene. It's really scary. So it's broadened out a lot since Alan started his work, and now the kind of the societies in charge are actually putting this stuff up online and encouraging people to look at it. Whereas, you know, 30 years ago they were actively suppressing it and telling people that they shouldn't look at this stuff because it's corrupt, because it's different from the modern different scores, therefore it must be wrong. Just don't look at it, it's dangerous. You'll stop winning competition.
That's scary.
It's horrible.
You know, here's the 1920s official book, follow that. Good for you.
But you might point out you're calling this Gaelic, but first motion two
he's,
times.
He's writing for his patron.
Yes.
Okay, this is written by Colin Campbell, who's a native Gaelic speaking Gaelic piper trained in the old tradition. But he's writing the book not for himself, but for his patron, who's an English speaking aristocrat.
No,
so he writes called Vual Doan. So that's his attempt to write it for his patron in English. Phonetics,
yeah.
And then he writes first, second, third. He writes two times. He writes first motion.
Do you know if he was literate in Gaelic or not?
No.
So
he might have been illiterate in Gaelic. He might have been taught to write in English.
That's
yeah.
sort of what I'm getting at. I've heard it said that Contract itself, the syllables aren't.
He made them up in writing. For this project of writing the music, yeah. That's right, it's got sound, it's got consonants that aren't in Gaelic, but
right.
they're good for notating the sound of the pipes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. His patron, I can't remember his patron's name, he sent his sons to Harrow School in London, and there's a Peabrook in the manuscript, which is quite a good 18th century style, it's not an old one, it's called Harrow's March. And we think that, you know, there's his piper, and his sons go to Harrow, and he thinks, oh, yeah, like fostering, you know, I'd like to march for Harrow. It's a good march as well, but, you know, it's really good. Anyway, do I have anything else to say about well done? Yes, I do. So we've got the words, and we've got the modern performance tradition, but how do we get to the... How do we get back to an older oral tradition, performance tradition? How do we know what the rhythm of this tune should be and the phrasing?
Songwriting.
Anyone else got any suggestions for us?
Poetry?
Yes. Yeah. So what do you think, poetry in general?
No, specifically.
Specifically, yeah.
Syllabic
or is it? So no, Gaelic poetry in general. Okay. Well, we can do better than that. Okay. This is the song that goes with this. This is the song that goes with this pipe tune. Okay. So obviously, the pipe tune is 10 minutes and it's very geometrical and instrumental, so you can't sing the words to it. But the words give you the pace, the phrasing, the style. And this is the work that Alan MacDonald's been doing: is matching these fragments of tunes in the oral tradition to the pipe tune, to the pure mod tunes that we know from the modern literate tradition, and then you can kind of reverse engineer it. So, do you want to hear this being sung? Let me see who we've got doing it. Kate McDonald, who is, she wasn't a piper, but she knew all the pipe tunes. She could sing all those words from memory as part of her oral tradition. But she also sings this song, so let's hear. She starts in Gaelic, and she explains, they ask her, you know, the man doing the tape, what's the year of this?
1970.
Kate McDonald, 1970. Yeah. Oh yeah, it's written on your sheets. So the interviewer with the tape recorder says to her, you know, I know I've heard you have a song for Merle Down. As she says in Gaelic, something like, you know, oh, well, I didn't know that bit, you know, how would you get it? I'm not very good, I'm not very good at singing, so sorry about that. And of course she's lying because she's a fantastic singer. So this is track 13.
I'm a
So I think what's happening, this is not a song that she sings a lot, you know, she's kind of remembering, oh yeah, it's not me, I suppose it's not, I suppose it's to sing it. And I think she sings through as far as here, she can't remember how the second half goes even, so she just repeats the first half, and then she kind of gets more, confident, she starts again, she goes all the way through, and she goes, oh, I quite like this, and so she goes to the beginning and does it again, kind of slightly off to herself and dreaming. Yeah?
Maybe from my own mother or from somebody that would play the pipes they used to.
Yes.
Did they have words for most of these?
Oh, well, for the Pibrach, they did have. It was composed, I was told, first of all in song, or most of them in song, in at the early stages.
I know you just keep repeating it in the next few hours, but you can all get it, it's online, and here's the web address at the bottom. If that's too much typing for you, you can go to my website and get a link to it. So I think it's the second half is the best match. So she sings something like, and that matches. You see the match between motifs and the phrasing and the stresses of the words. So this is vital, I think. This is the vital thing that almost all of the modern performers of this music have missed out. And this is why Ronan said in the concert, you can't listen to modern people playing the pipes, doesn't make sense. Because the pipers he's listening to, they've never heard, come across these songs, they've never listened to them, let alone put them into the music. Yeah. Okay, do we have anything else to say about this song? I don't think so. Let's go on, have a little bit of time. Let's talk about a different tune. Because one of the things I found is that each of these five tunes is very different in its style and in its shape and in the kind of sources that we have. And so it was great for me because you know, wanting to investigate the connections between how the pibra came from the harp. This was a wonderful project because each tune had a completely different set of challenges in terms of the nature of the sources and the nature of the evidence. So for this tune, you have the Cantilock manuscript and you have the audio recording of the song. And I also listened to an archive recording that I put on your handout from Piper from Callum Johnson in the 1950s, and he's a more old style piper. He's still playing it from the book, but he's putting a little bit of taste and style into it. And he was a good singer, so I wouldn't be surprised if he knew this song as well. And I think you should hear that. I'm not going to play it because it's a 10-minute recording. So that was my approach for this tune, to getting this tune up and running. But there are other tunes with very different sets of issues. So I'm going to show you a different one. I'm going to show you this one, okay? Now this is the one, oh it's gone.
It's blank.
This is a glass sphere. This is the one that the genealogy explained that Raghnall had composed. So this is the earliest attribution of a tune to him. You can see it's about 1820. It gets its Raghnall attribution. And it's the one that's most commonly attributed to him. And it's a very interesting tune. There's lots and lots of things about it that are interesting. One of the things interesting about it is its title, A Glass Sphere. Can anyone who doesn't speak Gaelic remember those words appearing in any of your classes? How many of the classes have done the Bunting Gaelic names?
This year.
Of all years, yeah.
Glass
is one of Bunting's terms, yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, beer, Krukagern beer is the wiggling of one finger, yeah?
Okay.
Because beer is your finger. And glass is this terribly difficult word that refers to chords. Who knows fake and glaish? Okay, glaish is a different word to glass, but a lot of people in the past have got them confused. And so and a couple of Gaelic scholars have been saying, yeah, this should actually be a glaish here. It's to do with the tuning and, you know.
Classic is to tune.
Yeah, exactly. There's these connections between glass and glaish. So even the title gets us interesting. Colin Campbell in his 1780 manuscript there's a number of tunes and he writes called a glass. But he doesn't write it in Gaelic phonetics, so you can't, does he mean a glass or does he mean a glaish? You can't tell, so you know, there's all these ambiguities. So. Okay, who can tell me anything about this page? I don't want to zoom in anymore. Who can tell me anything about this page? It's fiddle music.
And the tuning at the start.
Well, that's cheating. Yeah. So this is a printed book. This is Patrick McDonald's collection.
So then the notes aren't going to be the notes.
Correct.
You're going to be like in
Bieber. So page 42, tuning, and here's the tuning for the fiddle. Okay, so you retune the fiddle, and then you start playing. But when you get to this. When you get to this chord here,
it's not
going
to sound
okay,
like
so you've got two sharps. So it's B, and what's this note here?
So it's going to be your D. Where you've got open D string would be, but I can't tell at the start what note.
It's E, but it looks like D, so it doesn't hit a note. Actually, it's not that hard because it's all open strings on the low tour strings.
So it works like tab almost.
Yeah. But this was printed, you know, this was printed for, this is not a printed thing for traditional musicians, this is a printed thing for your salon musicians in the Edinburgh parlours, you know, to play a little harpsichord jig and then play a little piano on the fiddle.
So would you play a little bit of that fiddle, please?
Sure, I'll explain how it works.
Oh, how fun.
I can't find the openings.
Sun through.
I'm going to tune the basses up because it's not my fiddle. I'm going to tune the trebles down. It's the same effect, so we're going to be a pitch low from modern pitch. Okay. So this is how a fiddle's normally tuned. So it gives you lots of scope for playing big melodies and things, yeah? Is to go like the modern pipers do.
No, really?
Yeah. They all, every single one. So. So it starts with just two, doesn't it? G. But you don't want to play A, A, G. you want to put your fourth finger on the, well, you put your fourth finger on the next string there to get the G, and it sounds A.
Oh,
yeah.
So here's,
oh my God.
Here's A, G.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and so it speaks with a different voice.
Oh my God.
All right, depends where you start counting. I count one beer thumb, two for three, four.
Okay.
That's normal on the half, isn't it?
Yeah.
Four.
Yeah.
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 I'm trying to think.
Basically, you're going to end up the same note playing in a different way.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though it's like two different sides.
Look what's going on here.
So you've got.
So on this note, you play the two middle strings, the open A and the G on the next string. I can't do it because of my nails, but it's something like...
Yeah.
Like that, yeah? So you get this kind of double resonance thing. So there's all kind of interesting things going on in here, yeah? And so I looked at this and I thought, yeah, this is a completely different way into this tune from looking at the pipe scores. There's lots of musical, stylistic stuff in here that is taking us in a very different direction. Yeah, Thomas.
Are there any more there in the Scoil Harp collection?
Yes. Yes, there's quite a few. People tend to ignore them nowadays.
Where do you get this from?
It's in the library here, yeah. This book is not online. I had to pay some American person 20 quid for them to email me a PDF of this book.
Oh my God.
But I'll send you off a sneaky copy if you ask me. Because I don't see why some bitch American.
Is that the big one we have in the
library? Yeah, you've got a photocopy of it. You've got the photocopy of it.
Don't you have this downstairs?
Yeah, the library has a modern typeset edition of it, but not
the
facsimile.
Right.
Because it's a big facsimile.
Yeah,
and it sits comfortably on any of my shelves.
It's a big book.
So it is possible to buy it somewhere,
isn't it? I don't know where Bill Taylor did it, I think. He got it from a library somewhere. Yeah, this is hard to find this in the facsimile, but I've got it.
But it doesn't
look
like
the
facsimile.
I've got the
facsimile
collection.
Yes, that's right.
And if anyone wants, I'll scan it in.
Ooh,
yeah.
Very
yeah.
Nice.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, I see.
Simon, but this isn't in the Patrick MacDonald you have for sale now?
Yes.
Oh.
Typeset.
Okay. Right.
But yeah, the same tune.
I see.
So, and there is a song that goes with this. And it's, do you want to see the song? Or we should have a go at the song. Because it's good fun. We're running out of time, and there's another song I wanted to do as well.
I know we have two traditions.
Okay, this is a Glasphere, a bagpipe lament. It's this really strong, really beautiful tune. The stories that are connected to it are supernatural, you know, that it's the musician wanders. Oh, one of the stories, the musician is the nephew of an Irish piper who came across to Scotland and who was sent to study music. And his teacher was, you know, he didn't learn enough from his teacher, so he wandered in the countryside, couldn't play, with his pipes desolate, you know, almost useless. And he comes from a little cottage, and Max comes in, I'll show you a few things. And he shows him this tune, and so the lad goes, look, I've got this new tune. He said, where'd you learn it from? Oh, the old man in the cottage, back at the hill.
But there's no one living there.
Yeah, you know, that cottage has been ruined for hundreds of years. So there's a song that goes as a tune, and it's a really good song for such a serious, mystical, magical, otherworldly tune, connected with tuning the harp, and there's all these really kind of supernatural and weird sounds. Because the words of the song, obviously, are very good. Not at all relevant. So we're not interested in the meaning of the song. So this song, the meaning is not connected to the tune, but the phrasing, the phrasing, the timing is what we're looking for here. Okay.
Yes,
yeah,
it's the little Father Ted number.
So we can try singing this, okay? I'll sing you the first verse, and then you can try. So it's like this. And Anna MacDonald explained this, that that you naturally go all. So you put stress on the first of the three. Okay, so it's like this. And then the third line, you go third, second, and then the fourth line is all on the first. You see what I mean? Okay. And then the second one takes the same idea, and it puts that little motif, all in and down it, you just add that to the beginning of every line. All in and down it, all man hurt us, all in and down it, all man hurt us, all. So let's try it together if you can. Because it's serious music, so you know. And it is to have great pathos and momentum and power and, you know, a glass, like tuning the harp, like musical sphere, sort of this kind of supernatural, perfect harp. Okay, everyone ready? They've got this kind of abstract geometrical structure, and you think, yeah, that looks like people. And a lot of them do fit the pattern, and there are some that don't have an instrumental tune with them.
So it's probably just to remind you of the chase.
I think so. And also to remind you of the story. To remind you of the story. This one does not remind you of the story. Okay.
Not really.
However, the next one does. Okay, so Anybody got a spare? There's one spare. Everyone got one? Okay, so this takes us nicely. This is a nice bridge between music and the oral tradition, okay? So the story is that an evil landowner, and they always say he's an evil landowner, but who's the evil landowner in Mora? It's Ranald's brother. But you're not allowed to say that, okay? An evil landowner farmed the fields, and there was a poor woman who had no money or no food, and so she kind of slipped into the field and plucked an ear of corn to feed her starving baby, and the landowner caught them, and he was so angry, he cut her head off with the scythe. Really evil, really nasty. And so the ghost of this headless woman haunted the area and vowed vengeance on any member of the MacDonalds of Mora, that if they found them, they would kill them and everything. And so this is a great scourge. And Cross House is, here's the stream, look, here's Carisdarroch Beach, here's the stream, and this is the fields where Cross House would have stood. And so this road that runs all the way down here, and it runs here, especially right along the beach. And I think this is where, this is the especially lonely part where the ghost was out and about and doing its business. And it regularly killed people and was generally terrorizing the area. And at one time, there was a person being fostered at Cross House. You know, the old custom of fosterage, where a nobleman would send his son to another noble's house to be brought up. And it's a way of kind of, you know, the way that marriage is a kind of formal diplomatic relation between noble houses. So it's fosterage. So Ranald's foster brother was at the house, and he went out one night hunting. And the next morning, there was nothing left but his big, long hunting gun tied to a knot by the ghost. Okay, Ranald thought, no, come on, this is enough. And so out Ranald went, and I should have mentioned, this is one of the themes of Ranald. He's not only a great musician, he's a great, strong man. And a hero, okay? And he also has great supernatural powers. He's friends with all the witches, and, you know, he can deal with anything. So out he goes at midnight, and he stands there in the middle of the road, up at Tri is the name of his place, which just means beach. So he stands in the middle of the road, and up comes the ghost, and it says, he says, "Is that you, Ranald?" And he says, "It's me, who are you?" And it says, "I am the ghost without a head. Last night I killed and ate your foster brother, and tonight I'm going to get you." And so they grab each other and they wrestle. And Ranald's so strong, of course, you know, he's not overpowered by the ghost, but he's a match for him, so they wrestle up and down the beach until the sky starts to lighten. And, you know, at this point, the ghost is kind of terrified because it can't be caught in the daylight. And so it stops and says, "Okay, Ranald, you win. But let me go before it gets light." And he says, "No, I'm not going to let go. Why should I let you go? What do I owe you?" You know. And the ghost says, "Look, I'll give you a great house, you know, with horses in the byre and crops in the field." He says, "I've already got that across." And so the ghost says, "All right, let me go, and I will go away over the sea, and I'll never come back here again." And he goes, "Yeah, okay, that's a deal." So he lets it go, and as the ghost flees, it sings this song. Okay. And Ranald remembered the song and had it in his repertory, and apparently played it as an instrumental peacock tune. But we don't have the tune, but we do have the song. Okay. We're going to hear an archive recording of the song. Who shall we have singing it? Now, there's loads of archive recordings of this song with lots of different tunes. I think we should have Callum Johnson, because he has the tune that I like. All right, track 7.
So struggle a me and cool bang ye grass. Struggle a me and bell of no struggle a me. Oh, who go to and call the
understand why it's obvious that it's a Peterborough song even without being told, because the words are basically nonsense, and yet it's got that geometrical structure, it's got that kind of stretchy, expressive rhythm. Yeah, it fits the genre, so it's obviously a Peterborough song. For sure, of course, it would have had an instrumental, big instrumental variation set built on top of it. And for my CD project, I made up an instrumental variation set on it, which was kind of fun. But I'm not going to play it to you because it's not up and running, I'm not practicing it. But I'll sing the song. Okay? So that is. Oh, Santa because Callum starts and he's quiet because his voice and his mouth away from the microphone. But I love this introduction. It's such fun. Okay.
I wonder if you hear the old people talking, telling in stories about old Mac Ailein Òig.
Oh, well, Mac Ailein Òig was a great man. Oh, there were several stories of them. He resided at a little farm, cross farm, and he was invited down to try a house.
That's where the beach is, where the
murder was. Where Mrs. Shaw, she was stays today. And he had a son that had been kidnapped. when he was in Innsbruck, and kept up at the head of Rochmorra, near Milbo, in a cave. And he had grown up to be a sort of a child, you know, something uncivilized. When he was about 20 or so, he was sent back to Ronald, to Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig, and said, "This is your son." Ronald couldn't believe it at first, that it was his son. But he said, "He can stay here meantime and see if we can pick out his pedigree." So one day, Ronald was invited to dinner down to Try House. And Lord MacDonald of the Isles was there. He had arrived with a whaling
boat
over from Skye. And of course, the Lord was taking dinner with Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig and gCláirseach. And the crew of the whaling were in the servants' hall, well, with Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig's supposed son. The whaling crew thought they would take their eyes out of this uncouth looking man. They got a thigh bone of a cow and they said, "I wonder who can break that with his fist on the table, who can break the thigh bone of the cow with the teeth on the table." They all tried, but nothing happened. He came to Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig's son, and he gave it a bit and cracked the bone, yes, but hurt his hand at the same time.
Yes.
Accusing the Skye men of pulling his leg, yes, he set about giving them a doing.
Yes. Yes.
Raghnall Mac Ailein Òig had come along, and when they heard the noise,
uh-huh,
and got a hold of his, what was supposed to be his son, and he held him, and no more. Well, they said, "There's no other man I couldn't hold but my son easier than that."
That
oh, yes.
So this is the kind of thing we're listening to. This is the historical sources from our land. So it's kind of crazy stuff. How on earth do you start picking stuff out of that? So there's lots of references in there to places, to the people who are visiting. You know, there's lots of places, and you can point to them on the map. You know, you've got MacDonald coming from Skye, and that, you know, that ties us into the regional overlordship. You've got the cave up at Meeble, which is way inland, and there's nobody lives there now. It's sort of 30 miles from the nearest road, and a day's trek over the mountains to get to Meeble. It used to be a little isolated village. And you've got the house at Try. You know, there's things you can start pulling out. And then there's the themes. You know, this theme of him being strong, and of him wrestling, and that he could wrestle and hold anybody. You know, connected to the traditional wrestling games. But you know, there's always this thing. There's a story about how he was passing by a mill on the way to the village that's now near Fort Williams, and the miller played some trick on him, and in retaliation he went into the mill and he lifted the millstone off and put it down, and that was the miller completely stuffed, because the miller couldn't put it back on, you know. So there's all these kind of interesting little themes and snippets that keep coming back, and you're trying to build them together into a picture of what was going on. What are these people in the 50s and later thinking, and how does that relate to the age of the traditions? And the earliest stories, if you look at the timeline, there we are, 1826, you've got the first anecdotes about him. So you know, some of the anecdotes go back quite a long way. Some of the anecdotes go over halfway back to when he was alive. And I find that interesting. You can compare 1950s or 60s anecdotes with 1820s anecdotes to get some of the themes. Mm-hmm.
So Simon?
Yes?
How did you find this? Did you just type in
endless searching, following references, asking people? Hugh Cheat was very good. He had some, okay. He had some pointers for me, yeah.
Cool.
But, yeah, it was just putting things together, just finding things out by random, guessing. A lot more guessing and finding things out by reference, by guessing and finding things out by chance and Google.
Mm-hmm.
A lot more of that than of following normal scholarly okay. references. I don't think you'd get anywhere in this world anymore in this kind of thing just by following published references. It's a different scene. And you can tell by the kind of material I'm working with. This is not the stuff that you get in normal published literature. Yeah, this is different stuff, and that's what made it such fun, and I thought, this is new. And you can only do this in the last few years because of the stuff being online.
Yep.
Yeah, I don't think it would be possible to pull this stuff together and do this research 10 years ago.
Well, you had to go to the school studies and spend years there.
It would take years, that's the thing. It would be a life's work, and you probably still couldn't get all this stuff. Because the tapes have been catalogued. You know, if you, in the old days, if you go to the archives, and said, sure, which tape number do you want? No idea. And to be able to go on Google Street View and see his place, and then start putting it together with the stories, and go, oh yeah, I see what happened. Oh, you know, I don't have any stories about this place, and you should look at that place and get more stories, and the connections grow and grow. So I made a website, and it's here, this at the bottom of the timeline, and I think this is an important date for Raghnall's life. I made this website to go with my CV project, and all this stuff's on the website, and there's links to all of the archive recordings that I used, so you can just go there and click and listen. And I put some YouTube and so on right there, and different.
Cool.
So that's the real class handout, it's the website.
Mm-hmm.
All right, this is the last slide. This is apparently where he's buried. This is his tomb.
Cool.
So there you go.
Great, thank you.
Leave that up.